It's your returning champion, Elgin Tensity, aka New Japan Pro Wrestling. Just when you thought Vegan Gains started off 2019 the worst, Chris Hansen swooped in and said, "Hold my Mike's Heart Lemonade." Hansen, a god troll whom I've admired for many years, got arrested for writing bad checks for almost $13,000 worth of merchandise. He has since resolved this matter, saying that he didn't pay the bill because he was too busy, which for a reporter who hasn't done anything since last summer, ranks right up there with claiming that the decoy said she was 18. In the last season of Hansen vs. Creditor, he lost his house and car because he couldn't pay the bills for those either. It's ironic that the man who's best known for catching child sex predators got busted for disregarding the maturity of his debts. As much as Hansen has fucked up, it's important to remember the good times, which he and the laid-off BuzzFeed oxygen thieves can reminisce about in coding class. Enough about my fallen hero. Why don't you have a seat right over there? I have a few questions, starting with GJ Norton 19, who asks, "In the market for a new barbell for my home gym, which do you recommend? Are multi-purpose barbells sufficient for bench, squat, and deadlift? Or do you recommend specific bars for specific exercises? Muchas gracias, Your Trapsilency." I think a multi-purpose barbell sufficient for the big three lifts. Countless lifters make gains on Globo Gym barbells, which are shit, so there's no need to complicate matters. If you get one barbell, I think it should be Kabuki Strength's new generation power bar. It's very hard compared to most barbells, but has fine knurling, including center knurling for squats. Duffin has a video in which he holds a competitor's barbell up to the new generation barbell as the latter spins on a lathe. The knurling on the competitor's barbell is worn through after just a few seconds of contact. Definitely check out that video. If that doesn't sell you, Chris Duffin was in an old Gym Idiots video of mine yet still speaks to me, so he's as tough as his bars. Ryan Cameron asks, multi-part question, what's your favorite shave soap slash cream set, favorite shave brush, and favorite straight and dual-edge razor? Funny you mention it because I linked directly to the kit page with those items in the description box of my Gillette commercial roast. I use Taylor of Old Bond Street shaving cream, a badger hair brush, and a stainless steel Mercure dual-edge razor. They perform better than their Gillette competitors, and the companies that make those products won't make you feel like a scumbag. Andrew Allison asks, Traplord J. Pump. I've recently joined a non-commercial gym that has amazing powerlifting equipment, but also caters to CrossFit classes at night, which is really off-putting when I train. They also steal the chalk bucket, and I don't want to risk being hit in the head when one of them is dancing with a kettlebell. Should I consider moving gyms again? First, you should bring your own chalk. You don't want to use the gym's chalk when it might be contaminated with body glitter. Second, don't change gyms because of them. Record their antics and send the footage to me for my next Gym Idiots video. Once I put your gym on the map, they'll fuck off eventually due to the shame and paranoia. Just don't get kicked out of your gym for doing this. If you do, then I don't know you. Kentrola asks, Dear Traplord, I'm just starting in the business world and have to borrow suits from my old man. So what would you recommend for a beginner for suits, shoes, and accessories? Thank you. I'm assuming you want a minimalist wardrobe that gives you the freedom to mix and match until you can afford more stuff. First, don't borrow your dad's suits because they won't fit you that well and they'll probably fall apart if he wore them too. Get two suits of your own, navy blue and charcoal gray in medium weight wool. I recommend Suit Supply or a store like it for starters. If your dad still has his ties, then you should borrow those. A few solids and a few stripes. Don't get anything fancy. For the shoes, get a pair of black cap-toe Oxfords and a pair of dark brown quarter brogues or Adelaide Oxfords, plus the matching belts. You didn't ask about shirts, but yours should be white, pale blue, and thin blue and white stripe. Your starting wardrobe has to be really plain. The simpler your clothes and accessories look, the easier it is to mix and match them, and the less likely your coworkers will notice that you hardly own anything. Deadlifts and Death Metal asks, what are your thoughts on the USAPL transgender ban? Every fucking year. This pertains to JC Cooper, a transgender female who wasn't allowed to compete against females. If you've watched my videos on Laurel Hubbard and Mac Beggs, then you can figure out what I think, that it's unfair for a male athlete to compete with female athletes. Cooper got an email from the USAPL that said as much, but this news was somehow a punch in the gut and the dick. Cooper talked about wanting a challenge, training to beat her personal best, the transformative power of her body, excellent choice of words. If that were true, then he'd compete with the other men instead of picking dark side-filled difficulty. never be like Darkseid Phil. Whatever the fuck that says asks, what made you branch out from the fitness industry and roasting individuals that create fitness content? Also, are you going to review any shit fitness products anytime soon? I'm open to reviewing fitness products, but nothing I've encountered lately has been nearly as interesting as the Arch Lifter, which I roasted a few months ago. To your first question, I branched out originally because of boredom. The fitness world revolves around the same people promoting the same nonsense. Normally that would be interesting if they put up a fight, but I just kind of hit them with my lightning bolt and that's that. I continued to roast people outside of the fitness industry because the reception was always positive, and I introduced people to my fitness comedy videos, which in many cases they binge-watched. My Gillette video had this effect on people and caused some solid channel growth for the month. I might lose a few oversensitive dicktards, but those who don't come crawling back are replaced hundreds of times over. You get something different to watch, my brain doesn't leak through my fucking nose from making fun of kipping pull-ups for the millionth time, this is the best a man can get. Okay, it's time for all the questions about vegan gains. Here are a few of them. Thoughts on the Vegan Gains channel being deleted? What is your position on the termination of the Vegan Gains YouTube channel? And so on. There's no point in discussing this, because hours after I screencapped these questions, Vegan Gains channel was restored. Not to be that guy, but I knew this would happen. It only took him a few days, which beats Kenny KO's appeal period of 2 months, but not my appeal period of 1 day. This shit show will probably teach Vegan Gains that he shouldn't rely so much on YouTube. No matter how much he dulls his edge, the platform's too unstable. He'll spend countless hours on videos that could be demonetized or taken down for any reason, along with his channel. But he won't add new designs to his Teespring and hasn't been taking any online coaching clients. Both are more stable sources of revenue. No, he just plugs away on YouTube. For a vegan, he isn't very interested in planting anything and watching it grow. He lucked out with his appeal, but if he diversified in the first place, then he wouldn't need luck. Mikhail asks, what are your thoughts on the movie Glass? I thought the end was lazy and forced. If you want to be disappointed by that shit biscuit of a movie firsthand, then mute the video when the spoiler warning appears, but keep it running. It's poverty AdSense season, and your boy needs the watch time. When the spoiler warning disappears, then it's safe to unmute. Glass was lazy and forced at the beginning, middle, and end. David bumps into Kevin, the wackadoo from Split, and his ESP tells him where Kevin kept some cheerleaders chained up. David frees them and fights Kevin after going beast mode. Their fight spills into the street, where a psychiatrist who specializes in treating superhumans happens to be waiting for them. They're captured and committed to the world's least secure and understaffed nuthouse. Mr. Glass is already there, apparently hopped up on meds because he doesn't do or say anything for the first hour or so. Dr. Stapler, the psychiatrist, talks non-fucking-stop about how the superhumans in front of her are not actually strong or smart, despite ample evidence to the contrary. She's like every dipshit I bodied in my mean comment series rolled into one. Anyway, this is a complete fucking waste of time because we know they have superpowers and weaknesses. David's weakness is water, Kevin's weakness is flashing light, and Mr. Glass's weakness is conditioner. My favorite part of the movie was when they put the beast in a special cell that has flashing lights that go off when he tries to escape. Apparently he doesn't know how to cover his eyes. Mr. Glass is trying to set up a fight between Dunn and the beast, so it makes the news and raises awareness of superhumans. He builds up a fight at a skyscraper that happens to have a chemical facility in it, but instead they fight on the front lawn of the nut house. Close enough. Kevin, who goes into beast mode again, of course, throws Dunn into a conveniently placed water tank and incapacitates him. Then Casey, whom the beast kidnapped in Split, stops him from raging by saying his name and hugging him, because love conquers all or some shit. Here comes the twist. The psychiatrist was Illuminati all along, and tried to convince them that they're not really superhuman so that the world doesn't know about their existence. The Illuminati bros waltz in, snipe the beast, and drown Dunn in a puddle. It turns out Mr. Glass recorded all these antics by hacking the surveillance system and uploaded the video to fucking YouTube. Apparently Google isn't part of the Illuminati, despite having the makings of the number one fucking draft pick. The YouTube videos go viral despite being extremely violent and blatantly violating YouTube's community guidelines. That's when I, and probably Vegan Gains, wanted to be shot in the chest or drowned in a puddle too. The end. Don't see Glass. Okay, fuckaroonies, it's time for the lawyering round. Let me adjust my glasses of lawyering. Noah J. Murray asks, lawyering question, Sir Trapsimilius of the Swole Table. I propose a lawyering question. There's an echo in here. Of the two options, you must either choose between, would you either donate to Vince G's GoFundMe every single month of the highest tier, $90 a month, with the reward being treating him to the most expensive restraint in your state, or B, for 1 year, send me a free t-shirt of your merch in perfect condition. Thanks for your time. Speaking of time, the most expensive restraint in my state is jail, and the last thing I want is for Vince G to get free food and lodging every month. So I pick option B. I'll send you one free t-shirt for 1 year as a whole, not every day of the year, but the shipping won't be free. It'll be so inflated, Supreme Patty style, that you'll cover the price of the shirt as well as the cost of shipping it. Cash Hagic, my motherfucker who got the year wrong in the last Q&A, asks, Dear Trap Lord, I present to you a potential lawyering question. The faith of these people is in your hands. You decide. Yes, that's how this works. Would you rather restore the Vegan Gains channel by transferring all his strikes to your main channel, effectively terminating it? There would be no way to restore your channel. Or invest every single cent into EA and GameStop stocks. You'd have to sell everything you own and put that money into this. When selling your belongings, you're forced to negotiate the highest possible price for every item. Normally you'd end the Q&A, but your timing is off again. Vegan Gains has since gotten his channel back, so assuming he even has any strikes left, I'll transfer them to my main, as in first, channel, which I created years before this one and don't use anymore anyway. Ayo23 asks, You have committed an injustice against the Trap Council and have been punished to one of the following. Having to be Brad Dingleberry's training partner slash hype man for a month, or every person you speak to sounds like Cali Muscle for a month. I choose option two. It's winter here, so if everybody sounds like Cali Muscle for a month, then I won't be able to tell them apart from people with cold or flu-induced nasal congestion.
Like the video and subscribe to the channel now.
Everybody drugs them bodies sometime. Everybody tries the gear somehow.